presentations. Now we heard all our presenters. We still have 20 minutes for discussion. I think it's enough to frame. Please keep it short, keep it interesting, and the floor is yours. Please.
Was imposed in the communication of Bulgaria. in the Italian of the 19th century to differentiate that from the third.
Okay, we have another question there.
So, question to Annie. So much talking about, does class matter in cases like education? Is there any relation between social capital and identity choices? Education, generational things, so you live in a very monolithic social space, and I'm wondering whether or not people make particular choices based upon levels of social capital, or levels of education, or where they fit within social hierarchies of the area.
Yeah, thanks for a very interesting question, which of course complicates my picture considerably. It was meant to...
Yeah, but I'm not...
Mostly by the school. Yes. Okay, then.
I'm very clear that boundary between modernization policies after 1867 and what the option to state laws in terms of nationality, local language usage, school languages. And I'm kind of curious, in this, if you know much about how modernization policies affect this region in the Transcontinental area, whether or not that may influence some of these identities that talk about not being Slavic and some of these said after the war they saw. And also, sorry, as a follow-up question, after the war you talked about how this army that was representing this new political entity came in, which wasn't necessarily just a Slovene group, sort of army representatives or whoever you want to call them, whether or not that also affected the way people saw this initial entry into the Slovene provincial entity.
That could be the answer for starting the second question. That could be the answer. But nevertheless, even in 1923, they still understood and perceived those Slovenes who crossed the Mura River and came into the region as Slavs, which means that your idea could be true to a certain degree, but nevertheless. Regarding the first question, Hungarian National Voluntary Associations in Tekamaya actually tries to disseminate this idea. Slovene-speaking population which use ethnic Slovenes are in fact not Slavs, of Slavic origin, but of they are Vandals, old Germanic tribe from the early ages, which wandered through the Europe and settled in the south, North Africa, but nevertheless a small part of it remained here in Tekamaya.
Thank you, John Paul. You also have a question?
So I have a question for you. Do you know anything about the people who came into the Bulgarians who came into Rumania after 1885? I'm interested in the sort of pages of nationalization, internal colonizing. So people who took up land, people who took up work in these newly unified territories. And do we know anything about motivation? Did they do this?
Pardon me, I could not catch you guys.
Oh, sorry.
I could
see. So the after 1885, you spoke a little bit about homogenization and about agents of nationalization. And I'm just interested if we know anything more about those people who've entered the territories after 1885. Do we know anything about their identities or their motivations? Were they really kind of national activists?
If you are asking about the migrants, refugees from Macedonia, probably from after 1885, if I can say something.
Okay. So that's fine. So that's my question. I'm very quickly figuring out. This may follow up on Robert's question. Could you hear a little bit more about the Yugoslav thread in the period that you're talking about? Does this also play a role in school curricula and in a sense of nationalized Macedonia? You spoke a lot about the Slovene identity and trying to tell people that it was Slovene. But I wondered if there was also a Yugoslav frame to this, and whether this was causing tension. It comes back to the point that Stefan made at the end of his keynote. Is it possible to have two kinds of nation, Slovene and Yugoslav? Is state at a high stage?
This really is a great question, but unfortunately at the moment I can't ask.
Okay.
Because I stopped really in 1923 when Prekmurje was still under administrative rule of Ljubljana and of some kind of regional government and so on. I can imagine that things change considerably in the next, in the following year. But I will do that hopefully in the next years.
Following.
treat like an ant, of course, but maybe it takes you further to obtain the matter. After the near breakaway is mentioned, which was considered to be part of the Croatia, but it was disputed between Hungary proper and Croatia, and it also changed the appearance in political version. So when, at first, this mention video was sparked, but you are a historian of the first Yugoslavia, you know, the Oblast started in the early 90s. In the early 90s, there was Maribor Oblast and the administrative units in Slovenia and Ghana Oblast. And, part of Maribor was also mentioned here, which was immigration. So, in this part of Yugoslavia, Slovenia, Croatia, if you want, where these borders and also identities do not appear. Mecumurje, Prekumurje, and part of Štajerska, which was quite clear it's something Slovenian, although the linguistically can also. So, also the administrator of a kingdom serves towards it. Means had a problem with how to administrate this from this point of view. And we have still time for one or two questions. Yes?
Just a quick question. What about the other problem of Bethlehem? You should say, you have to so where the locals try to sell the ship, then it is somehow, if you get very glad about it, for example, which existed in Borloi in
Bethlehem. Republika Prekomorje existed on it for several days or weeks. This Republika doesn't have really much in common with what I tried to show. The administration in this part of Hungary completely deteriorated. I mean, it was like one vessel. People came to the region and proclaimed themselves for officials of Hungary. And I mean, government switched for 1 year and a half all the time. The Russian time. That was also the reason why the Yugoslav army was allowed to occupy this region in order to pacify. I haven't researched that.
One more question today, does anyone?
One question back.
I'd like to ask about the Gorani region. How does the Bosniak national narrative function among the Gorani? How do they perceive their own history in case they have a Bosniak identity?
Now, that is a good question. First of all, the Bosnian identity of being Bosniak Muslim is not just a matter of nowadays Bosnia and Herzegovina, but we have to realize that Kosovo and even the south of Kosovo is somehow connected because after all there is Sanjak, there is a sort of connecting Bosnia with Kosovo, and even Kosovska Mitrovica or Petrova Mitrovica used to be a part of Sanjak, and in every single town up until Britain from Bosnia you can find the Bosnian element. So in this territorial sense they might be perceived as a part of the Bosnian national corpus, let's call it like that. When I was staying at school, sometimes it was really strange to me in the Bosnian classes they were forcing the children to sing the national songs from Bosnia, Zadavika and so on. They couldn't properly pronounce the words and so on because their language is very much more similar to Macedonian standard. When it comes to the identity, It is an option. It is also an option offered by Kosovo, the Republic of Kosovo, in many ways. So they can have their schools, religious organization and so on. And they can go to university in Pristina and study in Bosnian language and so on. So it is also another opportunity in that slightly opportunist way. This is the same for the Serbs, actually. Why to keep Serbian passport? Why to be a citizen of Serbia? Because you can get some specific benefits out of it.
Thank you, and I will now must say that we ran out of time. Also, if you have any questions, please contact our presenters during the coffee break, and please socialize with each other. Thank you. Only 15 minutes. This coffee break is only 15 minutes, so make your coffee short.